necessarily blown over. The one up that you pointed out somewhere, it was absolutely blown over. Except this is much worse accident, but before that 6 months, three, four months accident, almost we can say there's nothing. And then he was given some answers and all this. So he didn't get any relief, whatever he had. There was no shortage of pain, no fever, some type of treatment, some concrete fever, no weight loss. In fact, there was a weight gain. So again, he went to same physician. Then he thought there is something wrong. So he worked out on more echo. So in that echo, the finding was pericardial cyst. A pericardial cyst, we don't have to do anything. If it is a cyst, then they were saying, echocardiogram was saying that it is compressible RV and R.
This was done by technician, cardiologist.
Both. Initially done by, not technician.
Anyway, I am talking about the echo.
The first echo was done by a technician. It was, he was not, I am not aware of the technician at all. But not from banker. Then Sriyas has done an echo in that hospital, Palestine, which was seen by others. And then it was seen by all of us. Pericardial cyst is very, very, very rare. They refer to me. At least you have a look. I said, no, this is not pericardial cyst. There is something else. So I asked the physician that you keep the patient and another worker should do. Set up CT chest. CT chest again, they said pericardial cyst.
The neck pain is very visible.
There was no. There was no good sign of why we said that these and that nothing. Not remarking. Yeah, I have not looked for that. Practicing, I have not looked for that. But he said that there is no other, nothing. Nothing like transaction, nothing like a carbonyl or something. Maybe he may be given a lot of diabetes. Okay. Maybe because of that, the picture must have altered. Okay. Usually it happens. Even the pericardial tamponade or pericardial infusion patient, if you don't have diabetic, the signs will go. Then for clinician to diagnose it's very difficult. So then CT scan was done. Then I have reviewed by two more radiographers. I feel that this is not. In this CT scan, you have seen there is a pericardial cyst, which is compressing on RARE. Okay. They have not mentioned the size of the pericardium, which is very important for such patients, for diagnostic
purpose. Size of the cyst?
Thickness.
Thickness of the cyst wall.
The wall was more than 6 millimeters.
They give size of the cyst, they give anterior, posterior, length and depth. But size of the
thickness.
Wall thickness, they don't give. Then there was a bilateral infusion also.
Right. Okay.
So infusion was there, so which was tapped and sent for collection. But this was
yes.
After admission here. This X-ray is after admission here. So infusion was tapped and which was also unremarked. You can say transmission. Okay. Maybe it was normal.
Bilateral infusions are there most of the time in this country.
No,
big detail areas and workers are only the routine makeup.
So, FNSC was also done, cytology was also done, everything was done, it was time.
ADA
was normal. So, I was having a doubt, this is something wrong. So, I asked on pulmonology. So pulmonology is a scene. I was next day going to operate. He said they don't operate. We need to come to a conclusion what patient is having. This patient was published back, then I admitted, then I reviewed all these things because next day I go operate. It was this in my list. Patient related was forcing us to operate. Sister Ricardo, after you got the easy then, to see such situation, I have operated, so I was having a mind that this is not pericardial cyst, must be something different. Maybe pericarditis infection, not one but in the cyst or something. So I asked the pulmonologist that you do and then you tape again, you send for culture, whatever, date, everything. So we have sent. Now one of the patient friend, very close friend of mine. He said that I think maybe next day you explore whatever it is there. Then we cannot, because by that time, by the little humor, people increase, liver becomes thinking that the little bit ascites developed. And I said, okay, anyway, we need to explore and see what exactly is there. So I went with the three possibilities in my mind, simple cyst, or normal cyst, or some constriction or effusive constriction. And probably I was going for the same diagnosis that using constrictive pericarditis. So we have opened. There were 850 ml of transmitted fluid in right pleura. Left pleura was totally gathered, so couldn't negotiate any nail or incision. But there we have aspirated some fluid, something in left pleura. And pericardium was thick, like 1 cm in size. There was a cystic cavity. Just giving the anterior pericardium, and then I picked that some 300-400 purulent material came, and which was compressing on RA and RB. Not only that, the epicardium was so much thick, 1 cm thick, and it was densely adhered to the RA, IV, SVC, IVC, and part of LV apex. And which was typical of constrictive phase of tuberculosis. So I thought that this tuberculosis only. Still I have removed everything, read SVC, IVC, and it took around 6 to 8 hours job. It's very difficult. I tell you, constrictive pericarditis on table is a nightmare for most of the patients. It's extremely difficult because everything is rock hard, you can't control, but in a 1 mm. You have to go in the correct plane to and without a heart lung machine support, we are able to free all major veins, all major arteries, and RA, RV, even AV group. The thing is that even if you leave behind a little bit restriction or constriction, in that case the patient will remain asymptomatic for throughout the life. And the believe the process of fibrosis will continue throughout the life, and again patient comes with the constriction. So I was confused what to measure because everything is covered in the last 10 years. So I thought I'll give just a brief review of what exactly is going on in Indian scenario.
The CT radiology is different mental size of pericardium. So you remove 1 cm, say 1 cm.
No, they say the cyst. Simple sister, sir, कुछ नहीं आप आधा घंटे में तो बाहर निकल जाओगे आधे घंटे में तो
ना पेशेंट सेवा
पेशेंट इस पर इस सीवीटी वाज 23 ऑन टेबल व्हिच वाज रिड्यूस्ड टू 14 द पोस्टऑपरेटिव फर्स्ट डे एंड देन ग्रेजुअली रिड्यूस्ड टू 7 दिस वाज विद द पीक ऑफ 5 सो यू कैन से 78 सीवीटी वाज देयर व्हिच वाज क्वाइट
Or tuberculosis is more than 6 mm of pericardial size. It's possible. One has to do pericardial only.
Pericardial only for all pericardial diseases, most of the diseases. Unless. So, I have gone through many articles, but I think
this was pretty percent of the
pericardial. Everything was said, it was confirmed. Tuberculosis. Which was by Arena. Here is not so good. The was positive. And I was sent for further investigation. I wanted to know what is the time. Because the AKT trial was also given by someone. An individual physician has given AKT trial or something. And in fact, the patient came, he came with the AKT only. So I have reviewed, this is at least the most relevant article. So you can go through a newer paper of this. So probably most of the patients are almost 75 cases are whatever TB patients are there. Most of the patients pulmonary cox and extra pulmonary tuberculosis is only 15 to 20%, or you can say 5% support. And in extra pulmonary tuberculosis, the tumor is used at the bone and joint, genital injury, MTB, TB meningitis, abdomen, and other things. You can say 10, 3, 5%. Whereas when the patient is HIV positive, the pulmonary TB is 30%, and majority are extra pulmonary tuberculosis or combined. So pericardial involvement in TB may result in acute pericarditis, chronic pericardial effusion, cardiac component, and pericardial ascites. And they have a very weird type of pericarditis. They may come in just malaise. They may come with just fever, or fever of unknown etiology. You diagnose, nothing will go. Everything will come normal, and suddenly the patient may have a tuberculosis pericarditis. In India, TB accounts for nearly 2/3 of the cases of constitutive pericarditis. So, whichever constitutive pericarditis comes to us, first we think of tuberculosis. TB has been reported to be cause of acute pericarditis in 4% of patients in a developed world, Western world, and 60 to 80% of the patients in the developing world. Now the burden of tuberculosis across the world is 8.8 million new cases every year, and out of this 8.8 million, 1.3 million deaths reported every year in 2012 review of international WHO. Indian burden, the global whatever burden is there, is 25% of the global burden, is just India. So every third of the missing cases that do not get diagnosed and noticed in India, every third, and these are not included in the list. Okay. Another thing, the role of private practitioner, especially in extra pulmonary tuberculosis, is very high. Whereas pulmonary cox usually goes to the medical college, the government. So they are registered and reported. Because extra pulmonary tuberculosis usually goes with a complication and they go to private practice, tertiary care center. These are not labeled. So actually, picture in the global model, whatever India has, very, very high. Another thing is reliable data in India is leaky, and they have a diverse clinical presentation. Many physicians start empirical AKT. Now these are also not registered because not diagnosed. Everybody must have started empirically sometime AKT in many patients. Even I have started. So these are not included in the register. In 2013, there was two bodies. One was ISTC. Another is STCI, that is the Society for Tuberculosis Control in India. Okay, they recommend expert MIB or RIFSL as a cartridge-based diagnostic method for nucleic acid amplification test, that is NAAT. And they recommend that. ETB, the most common is the plural, and which is more common in getting than 65 age group. Whereas in children, the most common is the lymph node involvement. male and female, there is a statistical significant difference in extramedullary tuberculosis, especially bone and joint. The female, they have more, whereas the meningeal and pleural lymph node is more common in the abdominal. Again, pelvic tuberculosis is more in female. There is an increased trend of bone and joint tuberculosis. The pulmonary TB, the most common presentation, only from the disease that is most infectious. Pulmonary cox is the most infectious, whereas extra pulmonary cox are not infectious. And that is the reason that Indian control board doesn't give more weight on extra pulmonary tuberculosis. And that is the reason that when complications occur or extra pulmonary tuberculosis occur, they are unregistered, undiagnosed, and they go to private practices. Because they don't bother, the government doesn't bother about extra pulmonary tuberculosis because it is not infectious, contagious.
Cardiography may reveal some pericardial effusion.
Now the echocardiography is a worst thing. Most of the time the technicians are they miss so many things. So whenever you have doubt, you have to ask the cardiologist to have a look. Now the worst thing is the cardiologist also not interested. So we have to go personally, sit with them, find out what exactly I wanted to see. And then only we can go and then you are operating. I have made a protocol to some unusual, I am operating, I will go and sit there for 20 minutes. Just 20 minutes, sit there and look at the echo and ask them, the technician, whatever. Because if you ask them, where is the pericardium, can you size the thickness, you know, size the RV, volume, RA volume, and then they will give exact. It is not like that they don't know, but because of the volume of the work they are doing, okay, they just check whatever normal routine they do and then send the patient.
6 millimeter is really made of normal pericardium with the size of the
body. Echocardiography is not a good investigation to the thickness or size of the pericardium. Yes, it is very good for how much compression is there. I'm coming to that. So, critical feature, the pericarditis occur most commonly in the third country. Disease is insidious many a time and may manifest rub, weak chest pain, cardiomegaly. Onset, acute onset has been reported in 30% of the patient and they can present with the cardiac tamponade. I have operated 2 patients of cardiac tamponade with pulmonary cause. Dyspnea, cough, weight loss are common symptoms, usually present in 40-70% of the patient. Chest pain, orthopnea, ankle edema can occur nearly 40-70% of the patient. Now, there is no specific randomized trial or study on tuberculosis pericardial or tuberculosis disease because of the 3 different stages and graphal patterns are different. And most of the this type of paper comes from the Western and not dedicated. Because cardiac surgeons are not interested in tuberculosis. They are interested only in serious. So they focus. You won't believe in whole Gujarat, only 2 dedicated thoracic surgeons. Nobody is interested to do thoracic work. So that is the reason that I was not knowing till this patient came what exactly the new treatment policy for extracted pulmonary tuberculosis. So pericardial effusion, the patient with pericardial effusion present with a chronic pericardial effusion. Patient may also present acutely with a tamponade, with a raised JVP, blunt, wide distal, distant heart sounds, pericardial drop, and pulses collapse. Then the effusive constrictive pericardium, the constriction can be due to thickening of either the viscera or parietal vena or in between the sac, there is a purulent material. The cardiomegaly, pedal edema, and raised GVP with a blunt wide descent. And after removal of the GVP is still raised and prominent wide descent. Even if you remove, because the effusive constructive, there is a part of constriction is also there. So even if you remove pericardial fluid, cardiologist will say, okay, I have put a pictate catheter and remove 300 ml of pericardial fluid. Now nothing will be there. Now you will do it. It's not like we have to report this patient for surgery.
You put in anything locally?
Right, I was about to ask. Like what because of your local injection after this one?
After you remove the fluid,
like in plural cases,
you need to. I have not seen any report of that. I have not. There is a role of steward, I'm coming to that, but not. So we think effectively AKP in some cases may resolve and commonly chronic constriction is
just to prevent that chronic.
Absolutely. So in constriction, usually what happens the inflow of blood is impeded due to thickened young and pericardium, especially in late blast. And these patients have systemic as well as pulmonary venous condition and manifest exertional dyspnea, orthopnea, ankle edema, and ascites. In see the so this is a CT scan of this is the picture taken from the journal. There's a pericardial stick. You can see here they have marked. The airway is dilated. There is the effusion both side. And on table, this picture is not good, but
good MR better.
CT is better because you can do for
border elimination is always better with MR.
Correct.
No difference the heart muscle and the pericardium and the exact fluid. Border delineation is always better with MR.
But CT with the contrast give you even mediastinal nodes.
It's for nodes and
not only that, contrast CT will delineate the heart. So if you want 3D reconstruction, it is much better. So they will give exact picture where exactly the constriction, where the calcification, which area I have to particularly remove the constriction. So there is the equalization of diastolic pressure and equalization of across all four chambers. There is a pressure equalization, diastolic pressure. Correct catheterization, nowadays nobody does correct catheterization. He used to study at that time, he used to correct catheter in our side to find out whether it is a restrictive pathology or a constrictive pathology. So, cardiac output is mainly reduced at rest, the prominent wide descent on JVP, and JVP may rise further with inspiration, that is, cosmone signs. When you see a pulsus prolapse, which is seen with less than one third of the patient. That may be because of the lot of diuretics, therapy or that, which signifies there is some fluid or relative elastic pain. And that is a very good sign for a surgeon. If there is a fluid, that means you can get a plague. And when you have an elastic pericardium, the surgery is quick, fast, and so constriction is less, fibrosis is much less. Many times the cardiac side is normal in constrictive pericardium. Systolic retraction of
the blood flow. Tachycardia also will be okay.
A lot of tachycardia can be there, but
over 110, 20 will become very difficult.
Pericardial knock can be present, but murmurs are not so common. Ascites is this proper name to Riva, that is called ascites tumors. Ascites occurs first, usually most of the then edema comes. So when the edema comes first and then ascites comes in the edema. So this is the hallmark of constrictive pericarditis, the ascites precox. Severe elevation of venous pressure may result in congestive pneumonia, protein losing enteropathy and hypoalbuminemia. After many years of repetitive venous congestion, the cardiac cirrhosis can develop. And usually because of the chronic chronicity, the myocardial ectopy will occur. This stage will not come. And this may be because of the extension of inflammation or possibly disuse of the muscle. And when this stage comes, pericardectomy, after the pericardectomy, patient goes into low cardiac output and multi-organ failure. So you have to explain to the relative that this is, and that is the reason that most of the pericardectomy series of constrictive pericardium is the 6 to 8% mortality. And the mortality and the long ICU stay and the long hospital stay is because of the long-standing constrictive pericardium. So, take home message, refer early to the surgeon. Like tuberculin positivity, which is this paper is basically from India. So,
refer early to the surgeon is interesting.
Interesting. So, you can say in pericardial environment, 75 to 100% of our patients are tuberculin positive. If you take the pericardial fluid, how it will look? So, the spore colors or silver cellulose, pH is not well described. So, cell count not well described, okay. The leukocyte count is usually increased. The polymorphic predominantly early. And later, mononuclear cells are present. Protein are usually high and glucose is low. So, this is a comparison between three fluids in a tuberculosis. So, we are interested only in pericarditis. So, yield of various tissue and polyfluid specimen by conventional smear and culture method patient with extra pulmonary drops. So, if you see the diagram fewer, smear microscopy is less than 1%. And microbacterial culture is 25 to 60%. This will give you definitely quite a headache to the physician to put on that.
Your APO is negative?
APO is negative. Smear negative, ATH was negative.
In the fluid.
He was on physical activity, right? You said she was on physical activity.
Gene expert. Now that.
Positive.
Patient can, on X-ray, you can find cardiomegaly, some cardiac calcification, linear calcification across the model of the ventricular activity. Associated pulmonary lesion you can appreciate on X-ray, if it is there. Pleural effusion or emphysema you can appreciate. So X-ray is important. CT scan for used to identify extent of pericardial wall and size of the pericardial thickening and fluid collection in the design. Lymphoid engagement associated with some pleural lesion like loculation or emphysema or septation. Pulmonary lesion also you can find associated with bone involvement. I have operated one consecutive pericarditis who had spinal tuberculosis, and which just came to the cock spine was totally missed. When it was referred to me, there was a cock spine. So this was long back in America. So we first consulted the orthopedic surgeon, we did two stage procedure together. First I did it and then he fixed the spine. Associated with only one can be there, and for surgical approach time, we have to go to thoracotomy, medial sternum. The medial sternum is the risk for all pericarditis. Echocardiography is useful for detecting the presence of pericardial fluid, which is such as collapse of right atria and right ventricle, free wall in diastole, which is diagnostic of tamponade. These features may sometimes precede the other clinical evidence of pericardial thickening. It is not an accurate test to detect pericardial thickening. Indirect echocardiographic signs such as fat pushing the left ventricular wall motion in the diastole, premature opening of the pulmonary wall, and may suggest chronic constrictive pericarditis. See, these small things here. In Baroda, not a whole Gujarat, not even a single echocardiographer you will find. Because these are very fine things. If you have any doubt, you are restricting and constrictive pathology, a good echocardiographer, dedicated one, you will find out, sir, it is not there. We used to have a very good echocardiographer, he was a technician, MBBS doctor turned technician. He used to do all echo for Amrita patients. And he used to find out dedicatedly, something is wrong, medical knowledge, sir, ye nahi lag raha, aap dekho, fir wo dekhna hai, on surgery table he will come personally to see, sir, kya nikal, like that, sir, here people are doing bother. Cardiac tests, nowadays we don't do, but for a theoretical purpose, for students, temporary cardiac catheterization is very prominent, why recently, right atrial pressing, and chronic constrictive pericarditis is a prominent wide descent in atrial pressure pressing and deep plateau ventricular pressure pressing, and characteristic of chronic constrictive pericarditis. And elevated right and left atrial, right and left ventricular, and diastolic pressure, and equalization. Equalization is only considered by equalization. If it is elevated on equalization, then it is a term. So, this is the, this term is the restrictive paramyopathy and this is the constrictive. This is the expiration and this is the inspiration. What I mean to say, this is the systole and this is the diastole. So you can see that there is an equalization of pressure in both. But what happens with inspiration? The RV and the RV, this is a, these are RV pressure and these are RV pressure. So you have to see with inspiration and expiration, is there any difference in systolic pressure? Here, what happens with the inspiration, the RV pressure goes up. This is the RV pressure. RV pressure goes up. At that time, the RV pressure comes down. Okay. So if it comes down, there is a paradoxical downward trend. It has to be downward trend. Then it diagnoses the constrictive paramyopathy. And you can see what I have spoken. So that comes to diagnostic. So what is the exam test and the other one is ADA. Now ADA enzyme, it is a purely metabolite which catalyzes adenosine to adenosine and on most human tissue, particularly in lymphoid tissue. The ADA estimation has been found to be useful in diagnosis of pulmonary cause, pleural lesion and ascites. High ADA level has also been reported in effusion due to rheumatoid arthritis, chronic lymphatic leukemia, empyema, paraneoplasia, pneumonic effusions, mesothelioma. Sensitivity and specificity of ADA estimation in diagnosis of extrapulmonary cox is coming in tail. Now ADA, there are two types of ADA, ADA 1 and ADA 2. Now each with unique bioparticle properties. The ADA is a ADA1 is an isoenzyme found in cells with the highest activity in lymphocyte and monocyte. Whereas ADA2 is an isoenzyme appear to be found only in monocytes. In tuberculous pleural effusion, ADA2 isoenzyme is considered to be primarily responsible for total ADA activity. While in paraneoplastic effusion, the ADA1 isoenzyme is the major isoenzyme of ADA. So when you have a doubt, should ask for ADA2. I don't know whether it is available in progress. Thus, the measurement of individualized isoenzyme of ADA can enhance the diagnostic utility of ADA estimation in pleural effusions. Now, this interferon gamma is cytokine produced by activated T lymphocyte. It plays a fundamental role in immune response to tuberculosis. High level has been reported in tuberculosis diffusion, possibly related to in situ stimulation of CD4 plus T lymphocyte by tuberculosis antigen. A few studies have been shown better sensitivity and specificity of pleural IL and Y level as compared to ADA. The sensitivity and specificity in the diagnosis of pleural tuberculosis are shown in this. First, we will come to this. So, this is ADA and this is interferon gamma. So, in a pericardial fluid, these three, Dogan, Burgers, and Hedgehog, you can see the sensitivity and specificity, almost 100%. Specificity is 83, 68 and 94. Okay. Whereas interferon Y, the 100% sensitivity. So, molecular work, yes. Many of the molecular methods are researchable and not available widely. Polymerase chain reaction has often been applied to CSF and pleural fluid to detect various signals representing DNA or M tuberculosis. Though the diagnostic utility of PCR in blood the other body fluids such as ascites, urine, pericardial fluid, must from cold abscess and tissue by abscess present has been studied. The available evidence is far from promising. And these tests must be interpreted in an appropriate clinical situation to their possible. PCR alone must not be a sole evidence on which AKT is initiated or withheld. So, associated pleural or pulmonary disease in patient of various forms of extrapulmonary tuberculosis, like lymph node, almost 32% of the patient in this particular group they found is associated with pulmonary or pleural disease. Now, this particular paper has mentioned the various lady information with extrapulmonary tuberculosis. The severe form, the category 1, and the less severe form, category 3. And they have not mentioned what is category 2, and what exactly category 1 and what exactly category 3. Which patient falls in category 3 in this particular paper? So I am not able to give you that exactly.
It's safer to go in category 1 or 2.
It is better to go for category 1.
I think we skip this and go to surgical.
Surgical management, I'm not going to speak, sir, because there's nothing in surgery.
Okay.
Anyway, indication of surgery. Indication of surgery.
I'm coming. So, summary of recent control, randomized controlled trial of additional corticosteroid treatment in patients with extrapulmonary pox. So, this study, what they have total practice over 53 patients and it is for 61 patients. Daily streptomycin, INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide for 14 weeks followed by INH and rifampicin for 6 months. The absence, they have commented, in the absence of specific contraindication, ADT should be initially submitted under the steroid.
The old trial.
Very old trial. So the Haki, okay, they said that practice around 29 patients and Facebook, but a very small number. But he commented, actual practice around produced a pronounced reduction in mortality, but no difference in the rate of radiological echocardiographical resolution of pericardial pressure. So whether to give prednisolone or not to give, I am not doing any question. Anyway, we operate, we don't give for 6 months. By 6 weeks, after that we refer back to the pharmacologist or physician. So I don't know after that what they are doing. So antiretroviral drugs, because in this paper it was mentioned, I have mentioned. Whenever there is an HIV infection, CD4, CD8 count, they have to do, and this heart, when we are giving association to the AKT, there may be a paradoxical worsening of state, and the immune reconstitution syndrome can occur. And it must be distinguished from poor response to the treatment failure or drug resistance or due to alternate diagnosis. Rifampicin co-administered along with the antiretroviral drugs by introducing inducing hepatic P450 pathway, it can result in a dangerously low level of antiretroviral drugs. That is a thing. Surgery is often required to procure specimen for diagnostic testing. And for any complication like tamponade or constrictive pericarditis, where it will become life-saving. Detail regarding the surgical management is beyond the scope of the surgery.
See, I have come across two patients of this, and whatever I have read, is the pericardial thickness.